Welcome back everyone to theCUBE's live coverage here in Washington, D.C. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE at Bob La Liberté, Nutanix NEXT 2025. We got a great guest here, longtime customer of Nutanix, but a keynote presenter, great guest, Mike Taylor, Hospital Ship Joint Task Director, Military Sea Lift Command of the U.S. Navy. Mike, great to have you on. We're talking about the hospital ship. Before we came on camera, so fascinating. For those who don't know, it's a floating city. It's a hospital, goes into theaters and serves people and causes and other things. Welcome to theCUBE.
Thank you so much, guys. Thanks for having me.
So you're on stage, big part of the presentation, migration from VMware to Nutanix. We'll get into that in a second, but I want you to scope the size of a hospital ship and the magnitude of the operations.
Yeah, the hospital ships are gigantic. Remember, they were built during the Cold War when we thought we were going to fight, you know, Eastern Bloc countries and take massive casualties. So 1,000 beds, you know, lots of capability to make sure our service members get care while they're in theater. Nowadays, we don't have wars that are that big anymore, so our new ships that we're going to be building are a little bit smaller, but we take up to 1,200 people, healthcare providers, mechanics, ITs, all those kind of people when we go underway for our primary missions or humanitarian, whatever it is we're tasked with doing.
What are some of the missions so people can understand some of the flavor of it? What are some of the missions that you guys do?
Yeah, so we do, our primary mission is, of course, combat casualty care. That's if we're at war, we have wounded Marines, sailors, soldiers, airmen that would come back to the ship where we would treat, we would help, and either send them on to a bigger hospital if they needed additional care, or we take care of them there and send them back to their unit. If we're not doing combat casualty care, another one of our mission sets is humanitarian assistance and disaster response. So, for instance, both Mercy and Comfort have deployed in support of typhoons in the Philippines or hurricanes in Haiti. Yep. Those are disaster responses that we've helped with. They have programmed humanitarian missions they do every other year. Pacific Partnership for Mercy, Continuing Promise for Comfort.
Excellent. So on the IT side, it's a floating city in my mind, but there's a lot of operational things. Just take us through some of the things that are set up. Plumbing, not plumbing, networking. I always say plumbing.
Yeah, there's plumbing too. Hey, that's the plumbing of IT, right?
Yeah, you actually have real plumbing, but like you got networks, you got OSs, you got a lot of things operationally. Yep. What are some of the big things you guys have to do to run that, IT-wise?
So, I mean, there's of course shipboard operations. So you have radios and you have computers that aid in navigation, the engine room, everything else. So you have shipboard services, but then in addition to that, you also have a full hospital that uses modern devices and medical procedures and everything else. So everything from vibration sensors in the engine room to unique surgical suite equipment that we have to make sure we're providing, which, oh, by the way, is also wireless. So we have clinical wireless on the hospital ships. It's truly the full breadth and all disciplines of what you would do with IT, with a focus on security, with a focus on resiliency and redundancy. And that's one of the big areas where Nutanix helps us, because the core power plan of our systems has to be, it's running all the servers, it's running everything. It has to be survivable. We actually have a onboard continuity of operations rack. So we have two Nutanix clusters that will fail over to each other. So lots of IT going on.
Yeah, I was going to ask about that. I'm thinking that when you have all this IT gear and electronics surrounded by salt water, not exactly the kindest of environments. So I'm wondering if you can maybe even highlight a little bit about if there's any special modifications, things like that, that you need to do to implement this on these ships.
Yeah, that's fair. So there are shipboard requirements. You know, everything has to be grounded a specific way. Shock mounting for vibration resistance and things like that. But above and beyond that, there's a finite amount of power that the ships will generate. So we have to be cognizant of, okay, well, how much are we taking with our IT equipment? Environmentals. Yep. It's hard to cool a room on a ship when, you know, the ship is off the coast of Vietnam and it's really humid and everything else. So that we have to take those things into consideration where shoreside hospitals don't really have to deal with that.
And
water intrusion, that's a thing that actually, you may have heard me during the keynote, that actually happened to us one time. I walked into that data center on Comfort and salt encrusted on the Nutanix gear. But you know what? The system didn't miss a beat. It kept going. So things we have to deal with, but that's why you look for things that are resilient, that have baked in protections to make sure you don't lose anything, you know?
a lot of people are talking about in the industry, obviously VMware, Nutanix, people want to move to Nutanix.
Yeah.
Talk about it, some people just give up, it's too complex, some people grind through it, there's use cases. What is your experience with Nutanix, given that they now have the platform? What's that journey like? What were some of the key milestones and challenges? And is there scar tissue? Did you guys get through it unscathed?
Was it painful? That's the real question, yeah. I mean, when nerds sit around and talk, it's really like, okay, how did this really work? Yeah. And it truly, what I said earlier rings true. It was pretty anticlimactic. So you do a little prep work, you know, as good engineers, you know, you talk to your support people. We had Nutanix support actually come out to the ships, just sit right there on the deck in the data center and just kind of joke the whole time while we watch paint dry using Nutanix Move, directly taking virtual machines from ESXi, moving them over to AHV, with very small exception, and I mean very small. There was literally like nobody, because we're doing live migration as well. Yep. It's a hospital, we have to be online all the time. Live migration, nobody really knew what we were doing, like, because literally redundant systems took over and it was good to go. So from our use experience, and keep in mind, this is all the way back, for Mercy it was in 2019, Comfort was 2020.
Yep.
The tools have only gotten better. The processes have only become more refined. So yeah, there will be a lot of chatter out there about experiences people had. Nothing ever goes perfect. Even for us, we had, you know, two or three VMs out of 80 some that wanted to misbehave. But the Nutanix support team was there on site, worked through it with us, kind of over the shoulder taught our guys at the same time, you know, hey, when you plan, these are some things you need to look out for. Yeah. And those things are probably smoothed out now, so our experience would probably be even better if we were doing it today.
Do you get phone calls, no one makes phone calls anymore, but messages from other peers that have done, that are looking at this? You get a lot of collaboration on that?
Believe it or not, I mean, the military is huge, but in informatics, it is kind of a small, especially healthcare, it is a very small community. We have an old guard of people that have been either in the Navy or some of them in the Army. We all talk and share horror stories about products we bought that didn't really live up to the propaganda that they were pushing out there. I'm very pleased that Nutanix is one of those products that just does what we bought it to do. Like we've never needed to go out and be like, oh, well, our licensing was wrong, or, you know, hey, we're not getting the throughput on our storage. Like, it literally has just done what we needed to do.
Got it.
Says advertised, as they say.
Yeah.
So, quick question for you. When you're thinking about the operational aspects of this and managing it, is it something that you're always deployed with the ship when it goes out, or are you managing it from stateside remotely?
So, because there are times where it's on purpose that ships will not communicate and have no external communication, we do need to be able to do everything on premise.
Okay.
So, would we like to have the ability to do management from afar, or at least visibility? Of course. That only makes things better, helps headquarters understand better what our capacity is, what capabilities we have. But we built them to be self-contained so that if we don't have connectivity, we can still maintain the system.
Got it.
What's your biggest opportunity going forward? You heard the Nutanix story here at Next. You know their platform.
Oh, yeah.
You know the folks there. They're a super smart team. NVIDIA was just on, obviously partner with NVIDIA. There's a lot of action, not a lot of power on the boat, but we'll see how you get the GPUs on there. But what are some of the things you're looking forward to in your role to expand footprints? I mean, platforms are great. You can consolidate things down to a smaller footprint potentially.
Yeah.
Size factor, you're a floating IoT machine.
Yeah, well it's leveraging known good pieces of Nutanix that we haven't implemented yet. Like I spoke earlier about NDB.
Yep,
NDB may be a really good one for my admins and my engineers to have visibility into different parts of our infrastructure to help them manage. But more than that, VDI has always been something that we've really wanted to do. We have done VDI in the past, but this is around 2017, 2018, and tiered storage and other things back in the day, which was standard back then, couldn't really keep up with the demand. We actually had to decommission our VDI purely because the back end couldn't keep up with the demand that our crews put on it. Healthcare is an extremely demanding when it comes to IO, recalling diagnostic quality PACS images, multi-gigabit files, so it's a big deal. But now, with the advent of some of the, especially some of these new things that are coming out with the way that flash is integrated with GPUs and other things, I think now may be a really good time. And I have to be honest with you, my Nutanix support team is amazing. The federal side support team, if I can just give a pitch to those guys, they're wonderful, helping us to look at what makes sense for us as far as footprint, how many new servers we might need in a cluster to make sure that we can prepare ourselves for that, and more. It's really comforting, and I, no pun intended with one of my ships being comfort. It's very comforting to have a really intelligent, really, die hard, they understand our mission, they're there to support us, group of people with Nutanix that'll help us to build these things out and walk through the engineering process.
That's a great shout out.
Yeah.
All right, Nutanix, you hear that? You got a big shout out from customer. big opportunities, what are some of the things that are keeping you up at night? Obviously besides water getting into the boat, in terms of tech, on the tech side, what are some things you think about?
Truthfully, so the hospital ships have a charter to be able to activate and steam within 5 days. So they literally will go from a small crew on board of 80 to 120 people to 1,200 people in 5 days. And during that time, we have to get the entire ship ready to go. My biggest fear is that we'll be doing updates or something else to our Nutanix equipment or something else, and it won't go as planned, and now we're behind in getting the ships ready to go. Nutanix has been great about making sure that not only can we do dark side if we need to, so that we can update when it's the right time for us and not just as updates are available, but also keeping us in the loop as to what those updates do. When is the right time to, like, for instance, we're on 6.10. Our guys are guiding us when the right time to go to 7 is for all of our equipment. Yep. It keeps me and the teams on the ships awake at night, wondering if our gear's going to be ready. We have to be ready as people, but is our tech going to be ready to support them too? So we worry about that, but it's I have to say with Nutanix, I don't lose sleep. I know who to call if something's weird and it needs attention.
Yeah, so. Great support. Yeah. What I love about the military and what you're doing is a tactical edge solution that's going to have a real world implication because we're all going to be edge and AI factories.
Oh, yeah.
Physical AI is coming. That's going to map to what you're doing. Mike, thanks for coming on and sharing your story of theCUBE. Appreciate
it. Great. Thank
you
so much.
All right, Nutanix changing the game. Obviously, a great example of live migration. Not for the faint of heart, but healthcare, they have to do it. theCUBE is here bringing you all the live coverage. We'll be right back after this short break.